Is your code hard to change? Is refactoring very hard? Is your code not modular? Is everything tightly coupled, interwoven with each other? Are you afraid of certain parts of your codebase? Most teams have at least one big thing in their codebase they would rather not touch because every time they do, something else breaks. Are you not completely trusting your suite of tests? Do you have a tester in your team that runs a lot of manual tests before you dare release to production? These problems are actually a lack of good codebase design. They're an indicator of low quality. TDD, test-driven development, exists to help you solve these problems. I strongly believe test-driven development should be the de facto way of writing code. In this video, I'm going to talk about 7 common problems and how test-driven development can help. Let's get into it. The first common problem is bad interfaces, or no interface design at all. We've all seen these functions with 7 or 10 arguments, or no arguments at all and only consisting of side effects. And while these aren't always bad, they're a very strong indicator of low code quality. By writing the test first, which is what test-driven development is about, it's not about good unit tests, no, it's about writing the test before you write the implementation, you have to think about the interface before you write the implementation. The implementation details are not distracting you from thinking about the interface. Interface design is done while writing the test. When learning test-driven development for the first time, at some point this will click with you. You will understand that interface design is done while writing the test. Right now, if you're inexperienced with TDD, this may seem unintuitive, but if you think about it, while implementing the test case, you have to think about what your method will be called, what your class or your module name, or what the inputs will be, what the outputs will be. Because you are thinking in terms of inputs, outputs, and names, you are thinking about the interface, because that's all the interface is. You're also thinking, when you start writing other tests that are interacting with existing code, how they should interact. You are again thinking about coupling and interfaces. It's very important to do before you do the implementation. In here, I have a before and a after. So my top function is before I would have written this code without test-driven development. And the below example is when I would have written it with test-driven development. If I were to first write this test, I would think about the input, I would think about the output, and I would not end up with a function that has no arguments that would accidentally take the current date. I would have encoded this feature in the method name, and this would be very difficult to test because next month this function will return something different, and that is not a reproducible test. It's not a pure function. Another common problem is that of a leaky interface, which is a very fancy way of saying implementation details are leaking through an interface to a call site. In a previous video I've done on interfaces, I've explained the 3 different parts when you think about interfaces. You have the call site, the user or the consumer, something that is calling, using something else. You have the interface, which is what they're interacting with, like the TV remote. And you have the implementation behind the interface, something that is hidden from the user. You don't want the consumer directly connecting to implementation details. When I want to change the channel, I don't want to need a screwdriver to change this channel. I've got an example here of a file reader, which is reading 2 different files, the call site, the consumer of this implementation, and the implementation being located somewhere else, a class, a module that is being imported. There's 2 different files that are being read, but there is an implementation detail that has leaked through. The file reader is stateful because it is storing the location. The location could be the starting point of reading the file. If you want to read a file in batches, like 1,000 characters at a time or whatever, this class could have this feature. And every time you read something, it is updating the location pointer. There's patterns out there, maybe slightly different examples, that have this kind of thing. The call site is depending, it needs to access a internal, and it isn't an internal because it is something that can be accessed, but from the consumer side, from the consumer point of view, it is weird that you would have to manage this location parameter if you don't need to use it. It could be hidden away. This is a abstraction that shouldn't expose this, therefore it's called a leaky abstraction. Now it is very hard to end up with this kind of code if you write a test first, because the person that has implemented this probably has implemented the class first, the file reader first, and then came to the conclusion when he was calling it at the consumer side, hey, now I need to do this and this because otherwise it will not work because I need to reset this internal parameter. If you think about the test first, you start to realize that it will work this way before you write the implementation. So you will not end up with this kind of thing. You will not end up with the interface of having to update the location if you want to read a second file. Good tests don't depend on implementation details. The next common problem is tight coupling. When you change X, you also have to change Y because Y breaks. Things that maybe if you look at first glance shouldn't be related at all. They are interwoven, they are tight coupled. This is a sign of complexity. Code is often referred to as a big ball of mud or spaghetti code when it is too tight coupled. This means refactoring is hard. Refactoring is unusually hard. It is harder than it should be. The suite of tests exists so that we can refactor. Tests should have a good separation of concerns baked into them. When you write the test first, as in test-driven development, you have to think about the interface. But you're not only thinking about the interface, you're also thinking about my first test case. What is going to be my first separate concern that I'm going to work on? If you have to read something from disk, do some processing, then send it off somewhere to the network, then I already see three separate concerns. What is my first separate test going to be? I might want to isolate the core of the matter, work on the transformation first, work on the impure disk and network things later. I'm going to work on my transform function. I'm going to write a test for that one first. Here you can see I have a controller which is depending on a MySQL connector, and in my second example I have loose coupling. I have a controller which is getting a DB connector injected and it doesn't know what kind of connector that will be. It could be MySQL, it could be PostgreSQL, could be anything. The first one is tight coupled, the second one is loose coupled. This is a classic example of a dependency that should be injected. If you were to write a test for this kind of controller, you would obviously not implement it this way because it doesn't make sense. You cannot have your test depend on an actual connection to the database, so it wouldn't even come up as a potential solution. This would have to be injected as a dependency. You would make this an argument somehow. You would always end up with some kind of solution that looks like the bottom one. Connecting to a database is simply a separate concern. It is something that needs to be injected. Another common problem is poor testability. If you have a function that has many arguments you need to inject, or a function that has tight coupling towards other functions, or even towards a very complex or nested data structure, then you would easily end up with many mocks, stubs, and spies, and things you would need to inject. And if that could be very complex, that could be files that are hundreds of lines big that have to build this big data structure because otherwise this function cannot run. Usually this is a separation of concerns thing, and usually this is also an interface thing. You would never come up with this kind of complex interface if you would write the test first, because you would consciously first ask the questions, what is a nice interface to use? How would a user want to use this? Then you would end up with a different interface. A code would always be testable, by definition, if you write the test first. Another common problem is no atomic commits. These could be commits that are over 1,000 lines of code. Believe me, they're there. This is not an extreme example. These things are very difficult to review, and at best they get reviewed with a delay and are annoying to review. So this is something we want to stay away from. Atomic commits are a good way to work together with other people and to have a history you can rely on, you can understand a year from now. And this all starts with user stories that are small enough. You should be able to fit multiple user stories in a sprint. They definitely shouldn't span sprints. If you would have that, then you would have too many features packed in there and you're gonna have a real problem with separation of concerns. The second step is to create a plan before you start typing and think about the interface and the separation of concern. Again, I've mentioned it before. The moment you start writing the test first, you start thinking about the things you need to think about before losing yourself in implementation details, which as programmers is very easy to do because you need to move from a high level thinking to a low level details. And this is a very difficult change to make, so you better start with the most important thing first. So decompose the problem first. Big problems are just many small problems together. This is your first step towards separation of concerns. This is your first step towards a good interface to work with. The moment you write your test first, you have good separation of concerns, atomic commits becomes almost an automatically solved problem. It's very easy at that point. Another common problem is forgetting acceptance criteria or interpreting them wrong. If you are working on a user story with many acceptance criteria, you may forget one. You may interpret multiple wrong. And this is solved by having a closer relationship between acceptance criteria and test cases. Ideally, they're a copy of one another. Your test case would literally be the line that you copy from Jira, where your user story maybe is written, into your test case. This is the test name that you're using. This is called behavior-driven development or acceptance test-driven development, BDD and ATDD. And the last common problem I'm going to talk about is not knowing what tests to write. This can be in two ways. When you're not doing test-driven development, you are writing a test after the fact, you may have trouble deciding which is the most important thing to test. How do I mitigate the most risk? What is the most important feature for the users to actually be writing a test for? The second way is when you are doing test-driven development, you're not able to come up with the first test case. What is actually the decomposition of the problem? What is the first separated concern that I'm going to work on? And this is usually back to the drawing board, ask more questions during the refinement or the backlog grooming that you do, and make a plan. Decompose the problem first, understand the problem. If you don't understand the problem well enough, you cannot solve it. This is usually a lot more questions that need to be asked. But if you think about it, it is really good that in these cases you cannot come up with a test case. This is a sort of litmus test. Is this feature ready to be developed? Do you have the solution thought through well enough to start implementing it? If you don't, then maybe the user story isn't complete. Maybe the problem isn't really solvable in the current context that you have. It is really good that you don't start writing the implementation. The moment you would have done that, you would have written half the implementation, then run into a problem and would have wasted maybe many an hour or day on development of something that is the complete wrong direction. Now that you ask more questions, it turns out, oh, actually, we have written up this user story in the wrong way. We need to pivot to a different solution. We need to go that way. Test-driven development therefore forces us to really understand the problem before we start typing, and this is vital for high code quality. If you want to know more and learn how to write code the TDD way, I have a longer video which has many examples in live coding to get you started on your journey in a very practical way. To summarize, coming up with the tests first makes you do good interface design. It makes you think about the interface first. It makes you think about bigger picture things such as coupling and modularity and separation of concerns. And TDD exists so that we have an easy time designing solutions. It is very difficult to predict the future. It is very difficult to come up with interfaces if you don't write the tests first. TDD also exists so that we can refactor easily. The suite of tests will be coupled towards the interface, not towards the implementation. It will create less coupled code, and therefore you will have an easier time refactoring. I've tried to show a few common problems that software developers face and how TDD solves them. If you face these problems, I highly recommend you learn test-driven development. Don't give up too quickly. It can be a difficult skill to learn. And that's it. I hope this was helpful. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have any thoughts or requests or ideas for a future video, let me know in the comments and subscribe. Thank you very much for watching.